Oh, glorious day.
Glorious.
I don't want to make you want to shout a little bit, you know? Well, 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 well. Wow. Praise God. Praise God. Have you realized it's a privilege to know Him? Amen. It's a privilege to experience Him. That amazing grace. I don't know about you guys, but it just overwhelms me when I think about His love. And I think about how much He cared. You know, and I think that He died on that cross to pay for my sins. Your sins. And that, you know, I still think about that. When they put Him in the grave, they thought they won. But I want you to know that the power of God raised Him from the dead. Amen. Isn't that good news? And you know, here's even better news. That power lives in you as a believer. And it ought to transform your life. It ought to create excitement and expectation in your lives. Amen. Wow. I think it's just pretty cool. And here we are. This is our time to shine. We're coming to Easter. You know, and the world's going to look at Easter in many different ways, but the theme of Easter is not a bunny rabbit. Have you realized? It's Jesus Christ and Him alive. Amen. And boy, we need to proclaim that. Oh, do we need to proclaim that? And, that's why this morning, important questions. Jesus died for your sins. What does that mean? You know, and what is Jesus looking forward to? I want you to ponder those thoughts as we go through this message this morning. And I want you to think about that because, we live in difficult times. The virus, you have to admit, has been difficult. It's played havoc on lives. And you listen to those statistics on the TV news and you think of all the people who have lost their life. You know, and it's heartbreaking to realize that and realize, that, how many realize that God is the answer to that? God is He knows what's going on. And if we'll look to Him, He'll be a very present help in our difficult situation. How many of you really believe that, see? I want you to be persuaded of that. You know, I read an article, and this article really touched my heart because it talked about an infectious division. Not an infection disease, but an infectious division. And the article was related to the coronavirus and how much division this virus has created. Not only has it created death, not only has it played havoc on people's lives, but it's created division. You know, how much division is over there wearing masks? How much division, as doing, I'm going to do my thing regardless of what the health department says. I mean, the list of division goes on. And how many realize this division is spread into the church? You know, people argue about whether they ought to come back to church or not. And people argue about this and that. And it's created an infectious division that we need to make a stand against and stand up. You know, listen to 1 Peter 5:8. It says that the devil comes like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Okay? How many realize the enemy's out to cause division? I mean, you realize the enemy's out to cause destruction. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And one of the things, united we stand, but guess what? Divided we'll fall. Amen? We need to unite together as believers. And I want you to take your Bible and turn with me. And I want you to listen to this scripture, Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And I want you to listen to verse 1, and we're going to read through verse 6. And listen to what this has to say. It says, I therefore, and this is Paul talking, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. Now, let me stop right there. And I'm going to talk about the most important calling of your life. And that's that God calls you out of the darkness and the damnation of sin and causes an awakening within you that He died on the cross for your sins, that He paid the penalty, and you cannot save yourself. You cannot save yourself. Now you listen to me. There has been so much division. If I am not baptized a certain way, I'm not saved. If you're not washed in the blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ and you believe with all your heart and you surrendered your soul to Him, you're not saved. You can be dunked 150 different ways unless you've surrendered your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ and gave your heart to Him. You can be dunked 150 more times, and it will not bring 1 ounce of sin or savior to you. You hear what I'm saying? You have to be called, and the way you're called is that God releases His Holy Spirit, and that Holy Spirit gets a hold of your life, and it crushes you, it breaks you, it dissects you. It literally whips you to pieces and causes an awareness in you that you are lost and undone. Without hope, it convicts you and it convinces you. That call comes on your life that Jesus is the answer to that. Listen to this, guys. You need to hear this. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness and with longsuffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, there is one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. There is only one faith. That faith is in Jesus Christ, that He is the Son of God who loved you and who cared for you, who stepped out of the portals of glory and come and dwelled among men. When we were singing them songs, I'm telling you what, you ought to get excited if you're a born-again believer. You ought to get excited if you've been called out of the darkness into the marvelous light. You ought to get excited and realize, hey, I'm a chosen one. I'm a called one. Amen? And I'm called into that one faith, and I'm called into that one hope. And we're going to talk about that hope. That hope is one day I'm going to be with Him in heaven. How many of you ought to get excited about that? Yeah. You know, the Bible says, I don't know what He looks like, but when I see Him, guess what? I'm going to be like Him. How many of you believe that's a glorious change? You see, I want you to understand this: the only way to solve and defeat this division and this disunity is get anchored in our belief of the gospel. That get anchored as it is the power of God, or the gospel unto salvation to those who believe. We must believe. Listen to me. We must believe that Jesus is the answer. Amen? We must believe that He died on the cross for your sin and my sin and all people's sin. We must believe that if we repent of our sins and ask Him to come into our lives, He will forgive us of our sins. Amen? And He will bring salvation into our lives. How many of you believe that? You know, the Bible says in Romans 3:23, how many people sin? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All have missed the mark. Romans 6:23 says the wages of death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Okay? Now, think about this. If you start in the book of Genesis, how many realize God created a beautiful earth? Me and Carolyn last night were looking at pictures of Utah. I told her, I said, I want to go to Utah. She said, well, you want to go to Utah? And I said, it fascinates me. Have you ever looked at pictures of Utah and you've seen them, you know, look like smokestacks? That's not a good, boy, I bet the artist would hate for me to paint that picture. But you see all of those rock formations, you know, and they're all stacked all different ways. And that's just fascinating. But how many realize that's God's creation? You know, them rocks, it looks like, you know, a perfect hole in the center, you know, going through that. Well, anyway, what I want you to understand, that's God's creation, guys. That's God. And we need to realize in the beginning, God created. But here's what he did. He created the heavens and the earth, and he created this wonderful earth, and he created man. And he breathed into man, and he became a living soul. But then he told him, he said, all of this beauty I've created, all of this beauty, you can enjoy every bit of it, but one tree, don't eat of that tree. The moment you eat of that tree, you're going to die. And you know what? Adam and Eve yielded to that. And it says, because of one man's sin, sin has been handed down to every generation. Isn't that horrible? And you know, we're just like Adam and Eve. We make mistakes. We sin. And guess what? We try to blame it on somebody. We try to blame. That's, you know, Eve yielded. Adam just fell right in line. And then God come on the scene. And Adam said it was the woman. It was the woman. You know. It was her fault. But you know what? We've all sinned, guys. We've all missed the mark. We've all made mistakes. And what happens to realize that sin is death. The wages of that sin is death. The wages of that sin is separated from this loving, caring God. Isn't that pretty heavy? God told Adam, he says, the minute you eat of that tree, you will die. All these thousand years later, the promise that Jesus would come. He would come to die for your sins. Isn't that pretty cool? He would die for your sins. That as John 14:6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one gets back to the Father except through me. Why should we get excited about the name of Jesus? I mean, you want to go to heaven. You better get excited about Jesus because he's the way. You have to believe on him. You have to make that decision. But you see, to be called out of that, God's Spirit has got to deal with you. God's Spirit has got to begin to convict. Think about this, guys. I was raised in a Christian home. How many of you were raised in a Christian home? Okay, but that won't save you. I went to church every Sunday with my parents. Didn't like any of it. I heard over and over Jesus died for my sins, but I didn't understand that. Did you? I mean, when I was a kid. You know, and so I made a decision. The church was boring. I didn't want anything to do with it. I didn't understand, you know, he died for my sins. But in my early 20s, God started dealing with me. And I thought, God, I thought, I don't like what's happening. And so I got meaner. I got more rebellious. I drank more. I run harder. And I didn't want to ever be still because I didn't want to hear that still small voice speaking to my heart saying, you're missing the mark, son. And then Kerwin Heisner was added to my mix, and he was turned on to the Lord, and he decided every day he was going to tell me about God's love. And all that did was make me even more miserable. And so then I thought, I didn't like church, going to it every Sunday. Why would I go back to that? Because I didn't see anything that would help me. I'm just being honest. That's how I looked at it when I was in my early 20s. But God kept dealing, and Kerwin kept sharing. And Kerwin kept telling me about the love of God. Kerwin kept telling me that Jesus died for my sins. And I thought, wow, what does all that mean? What can that do to help me? And finally, after 6 long, horrible months of my life, drinking and working, that was my 2 ingredients. I'll drink to wash away the memory. I'll drink to be able to forget it, and I'll get out of that drunken stupor, straighten myself up, and I'll work as many hours as I can work at the mines. That was my life. Carolyn was somewhere off to the side. And one night, I was in that pickup truck, and I'd got to the end of my life. And I thought, God, you're either what Carolyn's telling me, that you love me enough that you died for my sins, that you love me enough that if I believed that, you would forgive me of my sins and you'd set me free from this bondage. If not, I'd just soon take my life. That was where I was at that point. Now, I want you to understand something. God's Spirit had brought me to that point. That is the scary point. That is what I'm talking about when He calls you out of the darkness. He begins to expose who you are. He begins to expose all your weaknesses. He begins to expose all your faults. And so I cried out that night in that pickup truck. I thought, God, if you are everything that Kerwin Heisner says you are, if you are of everything of what he showed me in the scripture, then I need to meet you tonight. I met him that night. He literally filled that pickup truck, and he literally come into my life, and he broke every bondage in my life. I couldn't hardly wait for the third shift to get over. I probably run that drag line as reckless as it could have been a run. But I jumped in my truck that next morning. I headed home, got Carolyn out of bed. I said, get up, we're going to church. She said, we're what? And she thought, something's happened to him. And we went to church that morning. And I want you to know that God, let me tell you, you talk about salvation. God literally broke the clutches of sin in my life. God literally broke that bondage. And God literally gave me a freedom and a joy unspeakable and full of glory. I realized he died for my sins. I realized that he shed his blood on the cross of Calvary. And I could have forgiveness and I could have deliverance and I could be set free from those things. You talk about joy. Carolyn scared her. Matter of fact, Carolyn said, man, I just wanted you to go to church. Is that what you, that was her statement. I just wanted you to go to church with me. I mean, you've scared me now. And guys, it literally, I want you to know, it literally changed my life. The alcohol crave was gone. The smoking was gone. All of my hang-ups were gone, and I had joy unspeakable and full of glory. Let me tell you. And when it talks about calling us out and that he changes our life, how many realize that he'll create this humbleness in you? He'll create this love in you that passes all understanding. That he begins to weed out and clean out of your life. And you begin to cause the word to come alive in you. And you realize, wow, how great this is. You know, we need to make a stand, especially as we approach Easter. Man, this is our time to tell the story. This is our time to say that, wow, we can be united. How many believe we can be united in Christ? How many believe that we can walk together in the unity of the Spirit? And how many realize we need to share that faith? That is what unites us together. That's what builds us as a family of God, and that we represent the kingdom of God here on earth. Our little corner here of what we do at Kincaid Christian Fellowship, our little corner of what we do where we live, our little corner of how we run about our life, we need to be the reflection of a Savior that transformed our life, amen? That has filled us with His love and transformed us and delivered us from the bondage of sin and put joy unspeakable and full of glory in our life. One faith, one Lord, one baptism. United together. It's the gospel, the power of God that sets the captive free. Can I hear an amen out of that? That's the message the church needs to proclaim today. We need to tell everybody Jesus died for our sins. And what it means is he paid the price. Amen? He paid the price for the sins of Adam and Eve. And when we believe that, we'll never be the same again. Amen? Never be the same again. Never, 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 ever. Amen? Does that make sense to you? How many of you need to sum it up this way? God loved Carolyn. God loved the Walkers. How many of you believe that? And he had a plan. He had a plan. That plan was that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Amen. Adam and Eve missed the mark in the Garden of Eden, but God had a plan. Amen? And that plan that Jesus would be the way, the truth, and the life. That Jesus had a plan to give you and I abundant life as we accepted the fact that he died for our sins. Does that make sense to you? Amen? And you need to accept that, believe that, and allow God to create a born-again experience. John 3, when Nicodemus come, he asked the questions, but here's exactly what he said. You must be born of the Spirit. You got to be born of the flesh. You come into this world as a fleshly birth. But if you want to enter into the kingdom of God, you must have a spiritual birth. And the Bible says, as many as receive Jesus, to them he gives the Holy Ghost. He gives the power to become children of God. And without that recognition, there is no entryway into heaven. Without that, you miss the mark of having the opportunity to come and experience the Heavenly Father. Amen? And you know what? We need to share that story. Think about this. How many of you remember, and I think it's in Acts 8. Let me find it here. And there's a story. And I want you to hear that story, because it's simply very important. And look here in Acts, I think it's 8:26. I didn't mark it here. Is it about Ethiopian eunuch? Okay, listen to the scripture. It says, now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, arise and go forward to the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert. So he arose and went, and behold, an Ethiopian, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasuries and had come to Jerusalem to worship, was returning, and sitting in his chariot, he was reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, go near and overtake the chariot. So Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah and said, do you understand what you are reading? And he said, how can I unless someone guides me? And he asked Philip to come and sit with him. I want to use that passage of Scripture, because the fact of it is, how many realize that was God orchestrated? How many realize that was God ordained? And here was a man. I see myself sometimes that Ethiopian eunuch. I was confused. I was lost. I didn't understand it. Didn't make sense to me. I'm going to church. I missed everything I guess I was supposed to receive at that time. But God started dealing with me. And guess what? I needed somebody to explain it to me. Just like the eunuch needed somebody to explain it to me. And God orchestrated. Let me tell you. You talk about God orchestrating Kerwin Heisner in my life. And Kerwin Heisner was the arler of that drag line. He came along and got on board with me. And it was a miraculous thing that he got on board. You've heard me say this before. It was not my... I had the choice of hiring who I wanted to be my partner. And had no reason, hardly knew Kerwin Heisner. And his father-in-law, which I did know, called me and said, would you offer the job to my son-in-law? Had no reason whatsoever to offer him that job or to go to bat to get him that job. And after I finished talking to Neil Cunningham, I said, I'll do that, Neil. And I'm in my mind, I'm thinking, why am I doing this? And I went to the general superintendent, said, I'd like to have Kerwin Heisner as my arler. And he said, if that's what you want, you got it. Kerwin Heisner got on board. He come on board. And he came on board with one design in his life, was lead me to Christ. To explain, as Philip did, the Ethiopian eunuch. Isn't that something? Now, let me throw a little footnote in here. Acts 1:8 says, when the Holy Ghost comes upon you, you'll speak in tongues, you'll jump up and down, and you'll run around, and you'll have a Holy Ghost rolling time. Did that say that? That'll happen too. That'll happen too. But let me go back and tell you what it says. It says, when the Holy Ghost comes upon you, you will receive power to get on board and tell somebody about Jesus. You'll receive power, just like Philip, that God led him to that place, and God used him to lead the eunuch to Christ. Number one priority in the church in these last days is to get on board with the Holy Ghost. Number one priority is that you'll allow God to fill you with the Holy Ghost and to use you and to direct you just as He called you out of the darkness as well. Okay? And you become a witness. And do you realize the spread of the gospel through the book of Acts started off of Acts 1:8? When the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Now let me tell you something else. You need the Holy Ghost in you. As many as receive Christ, to them He gives the Holy Spirit. When you accept Jesus Christ, the same Spirit, listen to this, that raised Jesus from the dead will come in and dwell in your life. And that is that born again experience, that you are born again of the Spirit. You see, in denominations and stuff, we get that all kind of screwed around. But the fact of it is, when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you invite Him to come into your life, that's the decision that changes everything in your life. Because the minute you believe and you're aware that you sinned, okay, that God has convicted you of your sin, of your sin nature, and you believe and you pray that prayer and say, Lord Jesus, I invite you into my life. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to be the Lord and Savior of my life. I surrender. And think about this, guys. It is a surrender because you need to be at the end of the rope because God, Holy Spirit, is dealing with you. Does that make sense to you? And you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, the power of the resurrection comes into your heart. The power that will set you free. The power that will give you victory. The power that will literally transform your life. Isn't that exciting? Isn't that exciting? Wow. But you know what? Jesus said, I came you might have it abundantly. And so what He does, He says, here's the deal. I'll transform you on the inside. I'll open the windows of heaven, give you a little shot from heaven, and it'll magnify you and get you excited, and you want to shout it. Amen? You want to tell somebody. You want to talk about it. You want to get on board with a person. You want to whisper in their ear, and you want to share with them the story. Wow, I got to tell somebody. Shouldn't that be the motivation of our hearts? Kind of looks to me like it's been the best kept secret in the church. It's time that we come back and realize, wow, I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I've been set free. Isn't that pretty cool? Isn't that pretty cool? I wonder how many trips we missed. I wonder how many excuses we made. I better not bother that person. I wonder about that. You know, I don't want to upset my friend. I mean, the list could go on, guys, but we need to allow the Holy Spirit in these last days to stir us up about the message of salvation. Does that make sense? And no different than the Philip. No different than any other stories in here. That we need to share the message, and we need to tell the story, and we need to let them know that there is salvation because Jesus died on the cross, and that we can believe on him. And you know what? We become that new creation. Now, I'm going to do this last one really, really quick. What is Jesus looking forward to? Have you been running that through your mind? You know what he's looking forward to? His wedding. His wedding. Isn't that kind of cool? He's looking forward to his wedding. Because we become the bride of Christ when we realize he died for our sins. And we ask him into our heart, and he becomes our Savior and Lord. And you know what he said? He said in John 14, he says, I go to my Father, and I'm preparing a place. And I'm preparing that place because the Father is going to tell me that I can go get my bride. And you know what they did in Jewish custom? They drank a glass of wine at the beginning of the engagement. And that was the beginning of this Jewish ceremony of two people getting married. After they drank the glass of wine, the man would go back to his father, and he would begin to build addition for his bride. And he would wait. And one day, as the father watched the progress, he would finally tell the son, you can go get your bride. And you know what the son did? He sat over under a tree and thought about it for 2 days. No. You know what the son did? He got on his donkey. He got his horn. And he started to blow in the horn. He wanted everybody to know. And he started shouting. And he gathered his best friends up and said, come with me. This is going to be fun. And they went through the town shouting and blowing the horn. Because he was going to get his bride. Isn't that pretty cool? Isn't that pretty cool? I mean, he was excited about it. And he wanted everybody to know. And you know, here's the interesting thing. If you read the parable of the 10 virgins, guess what the bridegroom was doing? Looking for the sound of the horn. Looking for the okay that the father was going to send the son after the bride. And so the bridegroom and all of her friends were looking to hear the sound of Jubilee. Isn't that pretty cool? And Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For I go to prepare a place, and if I go to prepare a place, I'll come, and where that place is at, you're going to ride on that donkey with me. Can you imagine that? But you know, in the story found in Matthew 25, 1 through 13 of the parable of the 10 virgins, guess what? They was 10 or 5 looking, excited, expecting, and they was 5 that got caught up in the disunity and the division, and nobody's coming, nothing's happening, and we're not going to do anything, we're going to, you know, and we just go to sleep. And then guess what they hear? They hear this young man on a souped-up donkey with a bunch of guys that are excited about their friend, and they're coming. And they think, hey, we don't have any fuel, we don't have anything. Give us some of what you got. Well, the church should have been giving all along. And they missed it. I don't know about you, but I don't want to miss it. I don't know about you, but the fact of it is, this one coronavirus has been pretty tough. I mean, agree with that. But I read Revelation 6, and there's 4 horsemen coming. And what they're coming with is worse than coronavirus. You hear what I'm saying? So here's my short version. We need to come back and say, God, unite us together. And what we need to get united together is that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through Him. We need to get to united that there is one faith, and that faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? We need to get united that as we allow the Spirit of God and cause that awakening, and we're aware that we have missed the mark, because that's what sin means, that you've missed the mark. It's like shooting an arrow at a target and you miss the whole target. That's what sin means. And as long as you are bound in sin, you are missing the mark. And sin separates, just like it happened in the Garden of Eden. They was driven out of that garden because of their sin. And we've had a wilderness world for all this time. But Jesus, 2,000 years ago, says, I have a plan. I have a way. And you can believe the way. And you can accept me as your Lord and Savior. And you can surrender your life. And you can look with expectation and excitement that I'm going to come and get you. Doesn't that excite you? And guess what? I don't want to be out somewhere in left field or in the bleachers saying, I don't know what's going on. I want to be with them that's filled with the Holy Ghost and excited and looking for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because I'm going to tell you, I don't want to miss it. I want to be a part of it. Amen? I don't care whether you put white socks or black socks on. I don't care whether you wear a robe or a crown. But if you got Jesus, I do care. You understand what I'm saying? These are the areas that unite us together. These are the things that bind our hearts together. And I don't know about you, but man, it says that I'm going to love one another. I'm going to be patient with one another. I'm going to be kind with one another. Do you realize that old Slewfoot comes like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour? He comes as an angel of light to try to deceive the very elect. And you know, I could spend hours telling you crazy divisions that people get disgruntled and pick up their marbles and go play in another patch. You know, sometimes I wish God would just crush all their marbles. If that's the way it is, just take all their marbles away. They don't need them anyway. You know, be like my kid I grew up with. He stuck everything in his nose or mouth. And this get back to where I believe in the power of the gospel that'll set the captive free, that'll bind people together. You know, how about that? You know, yesterday I was standing in a very busy restaurant. People standing in long lines to get in and long lines to get out because they couldn't get there. And it was an elderly gentleman. And he couldn't walk except maybe an inch at a time. And nobody was paying attention to him. His daughter that had brought him was trying to get helped. But nobody, you know, they was wanting in, they was wanting out. And so I happened to be standing there, and I stepped over, and I said, may I help you? And the daughter spoke up and said, oh, no, you're with a group, go on. And I said, no, that's all right. I said, may I help? And she said, yeah, but you know, I said, it's all right. And she said, well, what about all these people? I said, I don't care about all those people. I'll block the doorway. But we're going to get, you know, you out of here. And so I stood over and I got next to him where people couldn't get by. And it took us forever to get in the door. And I don't know how many times the man looked at me and he said, son, you don't have to be doing this. You just leave me. I'll make it. I'll get there eventually. I said, no, you don't understand. I got to do this. And I made sure that he got through the door. And I don't know how many times his daughter come up and said, oh, please, you don't have to be doing this. And my response every time was, you don't understand. Yes, I do have to do this. you need help and somebody needs to care, and God cares. How many of you believe that's the way we ought to be about life, in touching our neighbors and our friends, because God cares? And that we need to share the gospel in season and out of season. We need to alert, because you know what? Can you imagine how glorious this is going to be when you're in that wedding feast? And you hear, wow, that trumpet sound, and the dead in Christ rise first, and those who are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet him in the air. Doesn't that excite you? You know what I want to hear is of it? I want to hear him say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. Now come in and enjoy the splendor of heaven. Doesn't that excite you guys? Wow. I don't know about you guys, but it excites me. And isn't it cool that he gave us this parable of the wedding feast and just to help us get ready and to be a part. And you know, how many believe he's coming? I believe he's coming soon, guys. I think we need to sound the alarm. I think we need to tell the story, and we need to get excited about letting people know that Jesus is coming. And you know what? Shouldn't that unite us? Shouldn't that unite us that we are together? And when you come back to my original scripture, these are the things that put us together and help us build relationships. Well, you know, last thought, with Larry and Ann and a tiny bit of my help, we sent out some little notes to people saying Easter is here. We've missed you at church, and you know, we're doing these things, and we'd like for you to come back and be a part of this Easter. I want you to think, we only got about maybe 2 days at the most? 2 days, Ann's give me two fingers. And I could even see those fingers too, by the way. Okay. And if you think of somebody that you would like to send, give us the name and address, and we'll send it. And so we can invite and say this, what a good time to come back when we're celebrating the resurrection and when we're celebrating, the announcement of Christ lives. So think about it and get a hold of me or Ann and give us the address. We've got the material and we'll send them out and just encourage people to be a part, because I think we need to sound the alarm and cause a wake up. Amen? Let's stand together this morning. As you stand with me, the scripture that says, search my heart, O God. Search my life, basically. Search my thoughts. See if I've missed the mark. See if I've sinned. Allow God to do that. Sometimes it's not bad to ask him to take you back to your foundation. That foundation ought to be Christ. That foundation, no other foundation can a person lay except that which is laid in Christ Jesus. You know what? As one of the songs, all other ground is sinking sand, but on Christ, the solid rock, I can stand. You know, it's good to start there. Go back there. Rekindle that joy of that salvation. Rekindle the excitement that came into your life. Rekindle how God literally begin to transform you. And then from there to say, God, stir a freshness, a new awareness of your love and your Holy Spirit in my life. And give me boldness to step out for you. And give me ears to hear that you may want me to get on board with my neighbor or get on board with my friend or my grandson or daughter. You may want me to get on board with somebody at Walmart this week. Allow God's Spirit to touch your heart. Amen. And you know, if you're dealing with a problem, dealing with a circumstance, dealing with sickness, dealing with something, just believe God as we pray that He can touch that situation and He can turn it around, that He can correct it and bring healing, bring victory. Will you pray with me in that light? Father, thank you for your gift of salvation. Thank you that you died for our sins. Thank you that you simply became the way, the truth, and the life. Father, as we go back and we look, we're thankful we have that foundation in Christ. We're thankful for that moment in our lives. Father, I pray that as you search our hearts, Father, if we've fallen to the right or the left, or we've got sidetracked, God, just speak to our hearts and forgive us and help us get back on the straight and narrow road. And Father, I pray that whatever may be dealing with, sickness, circumstances, difficulties, God, may you meet it and may you beat it in the name of Jesus. May you bring healing. May you bring victory over the circumstance. Father, may you make a way where there seems to be no way. And Father, I just thank you. And I pray that you'll rekindle in us a fire. Oh, Father, I sensed that fire at the beginning. I wanted to shout all over this place. I sense that stirring of your Holy Spirit. May it spread through each person here. Oh, Father, may it begin to build. May it begin to dwell in us. Father, may it begin to arise in us. Oh, Father, create that excitement. Create that joy unbelievable. Oh, let it be the fullness of your glory in our lives. And I thank you for it. Come, Holy Spirit. Come in your power. Come in your glory. Oh, come in your might. Oh, let forgiveness and cleansing in the name of Jesus take place. Let refreshing and reviving of your Spirit move over us. Thank you, Father. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Love you, praise you, magnify you, exalt you, God. Wow. Wow. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus. Wow. Love you. Just ask it. Thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Wow. Turn around and wave excitingly at somebody. Amen. There you go. Amen.